Thank you for the chance to come here. This is always a pleasure. I love this conference and I love all the people who come. I wish I could see all your faces while I give my lecture, but I will do the best I can and we'll move on. I'm going to talk to you about COVID long haulers or long haul COVID and how it might relate to what we do in our practice, which is taking care of ME/CFS. And I want to start with introducing some terms. There's a term called post-acute sequelae of COVID-19, or PASC, that is being used by our federal government right now. You may hear the term post-COVID, long COVID, long haul COVID. There aren't really strict definitions yet of what these are meaning, but they all encompass people who don't recover after acute COVID. And then the term ME/CFS stands for myalgic encephalomyelitis, chronic fatigue syndrome. And I'll be talking to you about the nature of that and how we diagnose it. Just for some background, I am a physician employed by the Bateman Horn Center. We have a clinic, a research center, and an education arm. And we are a 501c3 nonprofit. And our mission is really to improve the care generally for people with ME/CFS, fibromyalgia, post-viral syndromes, and in doing so, we end up learning a lot and addressing related comorbid conditions like small fiber neuropathy, mast cell activation, hypermobile EDS, and POTS, which we'll also be talking a little bit more about in our talk today. So post-viral syndromes have been recognized for decades. And I think it'll start to be familiar when I talk about viruses that we know about. The first would be herpes family viruses. And these are viruses that fall in the same family. And the things that hold them together are, this is the primary infection that become latent, and they have chronic reactivating patterns, especially in immunocompromised patients. And we'll go into more detail on the next slide. Human parvovirus 19, West Nile virus, and other flaviviruses can cause long-term symptoms. And we're becoming more and more, unfortunately, familiar with coronaviruses. And I'll also talk in a little bit more detail about SARS-CoV-1, but many people don't know much about MERS, or Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, which was scary. There was a small outbreak between 2012 and 2014, but 35% of people who got MERS died. And they're still tracking. There have been a total of 2,500 lab-confirmed cases to date on the CDC site. And then, of course, SARS-CoV-2, which is causing the COVID-19 pandemic. I also wanted to say there's actually an ICD-9 code for post-viral fatigue syndromes, and it's G93.3. And also under this code is myalgic encephalomyelitis. And so if you don't know to write that, it's hard to find that ICD-10 code, but you can always put post-viral fatigue syndrome. So just to give you more detail on these infections, and you'll recognize these, herpes viruses can remain latent and can reactivate. There are 100 known herpes viruses, but the eight main types of viruses that infect humans are herpes simplex, varicella zoster, cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, human herpes virus 6, 7, and 8. And we do pretty well with herpes simplex viruses because we have very effective antiviral drugs. We have a vaccine for varicella zoster virus. And we have some antiviral drugs for cytomegalovirus, usually when it's in immunocompromised patients. West Nile virus, you may not know this, but I know everybody knows about West Nile virus and remember when it was a really big problem. During the time of the big scare about West Nile virus, a study was started in the Houston area, an NIH-funded study to track people with West Nile virus. And there were 144 patients who continued of their large cohort who continued to experience symptoms related to West Nile virus up to 8 years later. So 2 years after infection, 47%, 5 years after infection, I think using the numbers is a little better, but 44 of the 144, 2 years, 29 of the 144 at 5 years, and 18 out of the remaining 45 people in the study were still having these symptoms 8 years after their infection. And then SARS-CoV-1, this was mainly brought to attention in our hemisphere by an emergency outbreak in Toronto, Canada in 2003. And in the 3 months that it ravaged that place, 273 people had been identified and 44 died. But a study 13 to 36 months after their SARS infection enrolled, they looked at 22 Toronto subjects, 21 of whom were healthcare workers, and compared their symptoms to seven healthy controls and 21 fibromyalgia patients. But the most important thing is those post-SARS subjects complained of tiredness, difficulty sleeping, myalgia, and muscular weakness. And this was statistically significant in the healthy controls, but very similar to the fibromyalgia patients in terms of cognitive sleep, unrefreshing sleep, myalgias, and fatigue. So what is ME-CFS? ME-CFS is a chronic, debilitating multi-system illness characterized by central and peripheral nervous system disease. There are immune manifestations and impaired cellular metabolism. The early studies suggest this is something like acquired mitochondrial dysfunction. It's thought to be post-viral or post-infection in most cases, but not all. And this is a very good commentary by Tony Komaroff in JAMA in 2019, if you'd like to read. It's a very short but brief summary of the things we know about ME-CFS. We know from for 20 or 30 years of research that numerous infections can create a syndrome that meets criteria for ME-CFS. Epstein-Barr virus, other herpes viruses, Parvo B19, West Nile, enteroviruses, and other non-viral pathogens. And people with ME-CFS share the same core symptoms, which I'll go into in the next slide. But there's a lot of heterogeneity among people who meet these core criteria. And it may be that the type of trigger, the systems that are affected, how long they've been sick, and the development of comorbid conditions really makes it heterogeneous, especially 5 or 10 years down the road from their illness. And the most challenging thing is there's generally no evidence left of the infectious trigger. And that makes it very challenging to understand, you know, what that trigger might have been. So these are the ME-CFS clinical diagnostic criteria. These were published in 2015 after an evidence-based review by the Institute of Medicine. And really all the other criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome should be abandoned. And the term ME-CFS has been adopted as the name, as opposed to just calling it chronic fatigue syndrome. So in order to meet clinical criteria, the patient must have impairment of normal function that's associated with fatigue. But notice the primary symptom is not fatigue, it's impairment of function. And it must have been present at least 6 months. And all of these core symptoms must be moderate to severe and present at least 50% of the time. You must assess frequency and severity because we all have these symptoms, right? What differentiates ME-CFS from other cases of fatigue and impaired function are that these core symptoms exist together. So impairment of function, post-exertional malaise, that means that the symptoms flare after attempts to do activity, both physical and cognitive activity, and also upright activity. So the flip side of each other. So impairment of function and payback if you try to do more or operate outside your energy envelope. Unrefreshing sleep, and then either cognitive impairment or orthostatic intolerance. And that's partly the way this definition came about, was that orthostatic intolerance is very common in adolescents and people in their 20s, and cognitive impairment becomes much more of an issue with age, as with ME/CFS, not age, but duration of illness. So remember, impairment of function, post-exertional malaise, unrefreshing, any kind of disrupting sleep that results in non-restorative or unrefreshing sleep, plus either cognitive impairment or orthostatic intolerance. And many people have both. Those are the core symptoms. They must all be there together, and moderate to severe, and present at least 50% of the time. And there are many other symptoms that occur in this illness, chronic pain syndromes, immune and inflammatory manifestations, manifestations that seem like infections, sore throat, feverishness, and neuroendocrine manifestations. But they are not consistent across all patients and across all times of their illness, so thus the core symptoms. So when you take care of patients with ME/CFS, and we've been doing this for many years now, and dig down into comorbid conditions, you'll see that patients often meet criteria for pain amplification or fibromyalgia. They may have peripheral neuropathies, small fiber neuropathies, neuroinflammatory disorders, evidence of viral reactivation, sleep disorders, orthostatic intolerance disorders, allergies, chemical sensitivities, mast cell activation, autoimmune thyroid disease, celiac, irritable bowel, dry eyes, dry mouth. These are conditions, it's interesting, that can stand alone. You can have fibromyalgia and not meet ME/CFS criteria, have celiac disease and not meet ME/CFS criteria, but they're commonly seen comorbid with ME/CFS. And the more comorbidities, of course, the more ill and impaired the patient. Remember this, because I'm going to come back to this slide later. So the COVID-19 pandemic, I mean, we know it's been overwhelming, and we've spent most of our focus on severely ill acute COVID patients, and then our focus has been on vaccine distribution. And many people who became ill weren't tested, especially in 2020, or they had false negative tests. And primary care, honestly, was and is ill-prepared to deal with anybody. We're just struggling to keep up. And we know that acute COVID, I think you had a talk on pulmonary complications, but acute COVID causes multi-system disease. And the sicker people get, the more systems are involved, but lung, cardiac, I should say cardiovascular, neurologic, GI, and kidney disease. And particularly those top three, we see as core to the illness and persisting after the acute infection. And there's so many sequelae of COVID that we see in people after they've been discharged from the hospital: fatigue and sleepiness and cognitive complaints and pain, respiratory, heart. People develop pericarditis, myocarditis, get palpitations and orthostatic intolerance, lots of neurologic symptoms, blood clots. And I had one patient who kept going back and kept going back because she had symptoms in her arm, and finally got someone to work her up for a DVT, and she had a DVT in her arm, and many other symptoms. But as we're studying the post-acute sequela of COVID, PASC, we're seeing that these patients fall in two main groups. Those that had severe infection, often were hospitalized on oxygen, and who have lingering organ damage that's identifiable with objective markers. But this is other huge and growing group of people who had mild to moderate infection, but don't recover, or even have increasingly worse symptoms over time and impairment. And yet without apparent biological markers. Sounds a lot like what we know about ME/CFS. So early in the pandemic, in July, this was really one of the first papers published about people who weren't getting better after COVID. And this was published in July, and it assessed 143 patients 60 days after hospital discharge. And on the left are the symptoms, the patients with the percent of patients with symptoms in the acute phase and the lighter gray bar are the percent of patients who had the same symptoms at that 60-day point after discharge. And you can see that many of the symptoms have improved, but there are many very significant persisting symptoms, and particularly fatigue, shortness of breath, joint and chest pain, etc. There was a study published showing patients 3 months after their hospitalization that was from patients in Wuhan, and this was published in September, and it showed that there were many lingering symptoms, fatigue, sweating, joint and muscle aches, chills, edema, dizziness, sleep disturbance, shortness of breath. I mean, they just go on and on, the number of symptoms. And they did report that they felt some of the symptoms were improving over time. Most of them did. There was a survey of 1,500 people with confirmed or suspected COVID who gathered their information online together without physicians, this group of long haulers. And there were 80% of them were between age 30 and 60. The majority had symptoms at least 3 months, and many, many of the patients reported that the doctors had not believed them, not believed their symptoms. So there was this uproar online of people seeking each other online to talk about these persistent symptoms that were frightening. And this, it's really kind of tiny, but I just want to make the point that when this group published as a preprint a longer article in December, and they had almost 3,000 subjects, but it looks about the same. And you can find this at patientresearchcovid19.com, this report and the later report. And you can see the 50 most common long hauler symptoms: fatigue, muscle aches, shortness of breath, difficulty concentrating or focusing, inability to exercise, headaches, sleep disturbances. It starts to sound familiar, right? So, you know, how common is this? And that's really difficult to know, because there are these different time periods and different constellations of symptoms. But this paper, and this is pretty recent, this is published in June, said that the best guess estimates for long COVID based on information in the UK that's defined as self-reported persistence more than 12 weeks after COVID-19 is somewhere between 2 and 13%. Now, that may not sound like a lot, but you know, there have been 35 million cases in the US during the COVID epidemic. So this creates a large number of people who have persistent symptoms. And this this assessment showed what we also see, that those who are reporting these persistent long COVID symptoms are they're slightly more often female, which is interesting because the hospitalization and death rate was higher in men, more likely to be middle-aged, not old age, and they're more likely to be white, and there are specific underlying comorbidities. And of course, the ethnicity may have as much to do with access to care or education and the ability to join these groups and have a voice. So this was fairly recent, a review article published just in July, mid-July 2021, a very good review paper of what boiled down to 27 articles published since January 2020. And you can see the 10 most common symptoms in patients with long COVID starting to look familiar. But I think it's interesting that the altered taste and smell and GI symptoms are way down compared to fatigue, shortness of breath, achiness, cough, headache, and some other kinds of pain. So controlled studies are needed. These, you know, people joining a survey and reporting their symptoms to clinicians, you know, they all have some kind of bias. They're important. They bring it to our attention. But this paper published in April as a preprint really tried to emphasize that we need to look at controlled studies. So this is one controlled study. This is the preprint, actually, this controlled study, super interesting. There were more than 2,000 healthcare workers in the UK who were surveyed longitudinally. They, starting in March, they sampled their blood and tested for antibodies to COVID-19. And approximately 12% developed COVID-19 by lab testing. And the bulk of them were largely at the onset of the pandemic before we had good supplies of preventive gear for healthcare workers. So they surveyed these patients 8 months later in November of 2020 and asked them about persistent symptoms. And of those, 140, there were 140 who were seropositive, and 20 of those patients had ongoing symptoms, or 14% of those who, so 8 months later, 14% had persistent symptoms. 3% of those were ongoing, and 11% of those were episodic. So that's a pretty sizable number of people who had persistent symptoms in a controlled study. Three clusters of symptoms were associated with long COVID. One were sensory. The next were this cluster of neurocognitive symptoms, forgetfulness, short-term memory loss, confusion, and cardiorespiratory. And I'd like, this is really also, I think that orthostatic intolerance fits in here. Chest tightness, unusual fatigue, breathlessness after minimal exertion, and palpitations. What's super interesting is dermatologic, gynecologic, gastrointestinal, and mental health symptoms were not significantly different between cases and controls. That doesn't mean they weren't present. Those are the kinds of symptoms that can be really disrupted by chronic stress. Think about the HPA axis dysregulation, the effect on your GI system, and mental health symptoms. In fact, the mental health symptoms were so common. I put this graph in here to show you that among seropositive cases, they linked stress as 54%, and it was 57% in controls. And you can see how common all of these stress-related and mental health symptoms were in these healthcare workers during the pandemic. It doesn't mean it's negligible. It means it's important. We all suffered. And to just say people have stress or anxiety when they present with long COVID symptoms is obviously not going to be a very fair way to assess them. So what is going on in long COVID? Well, we don't really know. We think inflammation may persist for weeks, months, or longer. There may be either post-viral or immune-mediated disruption of the autonomic nervous system. And the autoreactive T cells and SARS-CoV-2 antibodies that persist may cross-react and create an autoimmune or neuroinflammatory process. And a good example of the long-term neuropsych consequences after viral infections was from the 1918 Spanish influenza epidemic, when they actually labeled the disease encephalitis lethargica of the patients who really never recovered. And then there were the patients in the SARS 2003 epidemic I talked about that went on to have chronic myalgia, fatigue, and disordered sleep. So I'm going to give you a couple of cases here to think about. This is the first case is a patient that I assessed remotely during the fall of 2020. She's a 70-year-old retired healthy female. This is a healthy, avid exerciser. She was a retired CEO. She had the resources to stay very fit and take really good care of herself. She had a concierge doctor. She was on losartan for just essential hypertension and had also started on a statin in July. But in April of 2020, she got a SARS-CoV-2 infection. She had COVID-19, probably got it grocery shopping, even though she was masking and doing the things that she was trying to do. She had a low-grade fever, extreme fatigue, a rash, and her acute illness lasted about 10 days. But then she just stayed tired. And she was tired over the summer. And because every time she tried to do something, she felt feverish and more tired again. She had post-exertional malaise, actually. And so she went to her doctor, she got lab tests, an echo, a chest x-ray, a chest CT. All of them were unremarkable. So, you know, she just waited and tried to give herself a little more time. And 5 months after her infection, in August, she decided, I've got to get in shape. I'm just deconditioned. So she hired a physical therapist to become her personal trainer. And this physical therapist recommended a very gentle reconditioning program. They started on Monday. She did 30 minutes slow on the recumbent bike and then rested a day. On Wednesday, she went on a 1 mile walk. And on Friday, now this is a woman who used to work out hard at the gym when she was 70 and had her own personal trainer. So then on Friday, she did 10 minutes on the elliptical. But after that last exercise, she got a fever. She became exhausted and very ill, so ill she could hardly do anything. She was unable to, she had to lie down or sit in a chair sometimes. She had marked fatigue. She had paired function, exercise intolerance. Everything she did gave her post-exertional malaise. She had to nap. Her sleep became disturbed and unrefreshing. And after she tried to do things, she had pain in her arms and legs and mild dizziness, not dramatic. But the longer she went with this, the more scared she got, because she got online to read about post-viral syndromes and started reading about ME/CFS and learning about it online. And because it sounded so devastating, she started having more and more anxiety about the fact she might never recover. So 6 weeks after this episode, she had still not improved. She hadn't really, no one knew what to tell her. Her primary care didn't know what to tell her. She saw a neuro COVID specialist and an ID specialist. And the infectious disease specialist told her she just needed to get out and exercise more. But of course, she was terrified to exercise more. They had to keep lowering her blood pressure medicine because her blood pressures seemed to be lower. And, you know, she wasn't super, didn't have any, not much cognitive impairment. She really didn't have a lot of orthostatic symptoms. Her sleep was disrupted, and she had a mildly low white count and mild anemia and a little bit of elevated ferritin. Those were her only findings. And that is when she consulted me. I reviewed all those things. And I asked her if she would do some orthostatic testing and have her doctors help her get the orthostatic testing. So here's what she did. She sent me two orthostatic tests. So the first one is above is in the upper section. Lying down, her blood pressure was 129 over 71 and heart rate 84, pretty normal. And I just put the pulse pressure in here as another measure, but to remind you, the pulse pressure is the difference between the systolic and diastolic pressure. So the pulse pressure of a blood pressure 129 over 71 is 58. I just had her check every 2 minutes in the standing leaning position. And you can see that immediately her blood pressure drops significantly from systolic of 129 to a systolic of 84. That's a massive drop in blood pressure standing. So she meets criteria for orthostatic hypotension, which is defined as a drop in systolic pressure of more than 20 points with orthostatic stress. And you can see, if you look, that her heart rate went from 74 to 106, that actually meets criteria for POTS because the diagnosis of POTS requires a heart rate increase of more than 30 lying down compared to standing. And you can see that her pulse pressure had dropped in half. And if you, the reason we're looking at pulse pressure is, you're think of getting a blood pressure out in the brachial artery, and that's just a little ways, you know, one of the first large arteries. So the pulse pressure is really a reflection of the peak and trough. And it's a sort of a parallel, not exactly, but to cardiac output, the force and the volume of the cardiac output. So you can see that her cardiac output likely goes down a great deal. She did it two times. And the second time she did it, the blood pressures were very similar. 124 over 68 dropped down to 80 over 64. And her heart rate didn't go up quite as high this time. But her pulse pressure, as you can see, dropped from 56 to 16. And there is a measure in cardiology that the ratio of pulse pressure over systolic pressure should be more than 25%. That's sort of an equation they use to know if someone's in shock in the ICU. And so you can see her pulse pressure over systolic pressure got down to 20% during her standing. So this woman has a very severe dysautonomia. And she meets criteria for orthostatic hypotension, variably meets criteria for POTS. Generally, POTS is defined as an excessive rise in heart rate and a normal blood pressure. So she didn't really have POTS, but she's got a dysautonomia. And she has orthostatic intolerance, but doesn't even know it. She really wasn't dizzy. She just knew she couldn't be up very long and she had to keep lying down. And that when she was up too long, she became very, very sick. I just threw this in. During this pandemic, I read an article about Noah Greenspan, who's a cardiopulmonary physical therapist in New York City. So as the pandemic progressed, he has a clinic called a pulmonary wellness clinic, and he opened a post-COVID boot camp. He wanted to bring in the people who survived COVID, over 70, bring these people in and got out of the hospital and help them rehab. And he started realizing his rehab program, the long haulers, the people in their 30s, 40s, and 50s weren't able to tolerate his rehab program. And he had to just revise and revise and revise. And now anybody who's recovered from COVID, he has them start walking 4 minutes in two-minute intervals, increasing 1 minute a day. And even then, sometimes they crash. And his quote in the article was, "We had to come up with this very specialized rehab and learn fast what's detrimental to people. And it's like putting together a jigsaw puzzle and disarming a bomb at the same time. And, you know, if you did too much, you could put people in bed for the whole day. And you meter yourself. In ME/CFS, we call it pacing. You have to meter yourself and wait a day or two and see how you feel. And you can feel so great, but you're actually hurting yourself. And think about that first case. She started small. She sat every other day, but she kept going even though she wasn't feeling very well. I know she wasn't, because she started with 30 minutes the first day, and then a 1 mile walk the second day, and then 10 minutes on the elliptical, kept pushing through and just crashed after three sessions of exercise. That's what we see in ME/CFS. I will say that once she addressed her orthostatic intolerance and treated her sleep and started managing her activity level, she returned more to her situation over the summer when she had activity impairment, but wasn't quite so impaired. So the second case I want to share with you is a patient we saw in our clinic at Bateman Horn Center. We have seen a limited number of long COVID patients. We've asked to see COVID patients who were not hospitalized and who'd been sick at least 3 months. He came to see us when it had been 7 months after his COVID infection. He was 45 years old. And we created a survey of that patients could complete before these questionnaires, before they come into clinic. And one of the things we asked were information about meeting the Institute of Medicine ME/CFS criteria. So you'll see on the next two slides how he ranked fatigue and impaired function and post-exertional malaise and the other core symptoms of sleep, cognitive impairment, and orthostatic intolerance. So his impaired function, fatigue, and post-exertional malaise are severe and present 75 to 100% of the time. Here's a description of what he can do. On 2 or 3 days a month, which he calls good days, he can manage 8 hours of upright activity, hours of upright activity. So HUA is an abbreviation we use in our clinic, and it stands for hours of upright activity. And if you see on the bottom of the slide, that means time spent with feet on the floor. So seated, standing, or walking, if your feet are on the floor, like what we do all day. And he can only do 8 hours of upright activity. And the rest of the month, he can only manage 2 hours of upright activity. So he can only sit on the couch, make food, but he can't stand very long, walk around the house. Otherwise, he has to lie down and elevate his feet. So what can possibly make someone so they're unable to have more than 2 hours of feet on the floor time in 24 hours, especially a healthy 45-year-old male? He also has unrefreshing sleep, and he moderate and present 50% of the time. So he meets the criteria there. He has cognitive impairment, which he describes as severe and present 50 to 75% of the time. And orthostatic intolerance, we ask about this in several ways in our survey, very severe and 75 to 100% of the time. Most people don't know what orthostatic intolerance means. It just means symptoms develop when you're in the upright position that resolve when you lie down. So he has that. And so he meets ME/CFS criteria because he has all five core symptoms occurring together for more than 6 months. He also has a lot of other symptoms, shortness of breath, not quite as ever present and not quite as severe. Myalgias, headaches, nausea. He still has mild loss of taste and smell, skin rashes, tinnitus, vision problems, and allergies. The last ones are mild and infrequent or insignificant. So he's highly symptomatic, but what is it that's keeping him from being able to function? So we had him undergo, again, orthostatic testing. We call this the 10-minute NASA lean test because these upright tests were developed and really pioneered way back in early research at NASA. Of course, they have much more sophisticated ways now, but the NASA lean test requires, these are the pictures after in the standing position, requires you to lie down for, we have people lie down in a quiet room for 15 minutes before we start, measure their heart rate and blood pressure lying down. Then we have them move to a very close location against the wall, put a pulse ox on one finger to monitor their heart rate, and then put a blood pressure cuff on their other arm. We use two people to do this, one to observe the patient and collect and do the blood pressure, and one to write the numbers down and also observe the patient, because you can certainly have people go down during this test, even normal people sometimes. So here's what we saw in our male 45-year-old teacher with long COVID who meets ME/CFS criteria. And so the first two measurements, you can see our supine. We always measure it twice just to make sure we're getting it correctly. And you can see his heart rate was around 62 to 65 with a blood pressure of 115 over 75. We moved him. We had him lean against the wall, relaxed. And you can see he holds his blood pressure pretty well. In fact, his blood pressure goes up just a little bit, but his heart rate goes from 65 to 138 in the eighth minute. And we really had to stop the test because I think if we kept going, he was probably going to pass out, and there's really no reason to continue the test long enough to have someone pass out. We could see that he had POTS. So his heart rate went from 65 to 138. That's an increase of 73 beats per minute simply from standing in the upright position. That's severe POTS. So when you're seeing people with that you think may have long COVID, some of the comorbid conditions that we see are these, and this is what we've seen in our clinic. We've seen about 50 long COVID patients, and we've done a very extensive intake, questionnaires, a typical medical workup for all the known post-acute sequelae of COVID. You know, they get their all of their symptoms worked up, and but these are some of the things that are a little bit more easy to miss. So I want to call your attention to it. The first, we've just had these two cases, POTS and orthostatic hypotension or other forms of dysautonomia. Very, very common. As are just inappropriate tachycardia even in other positions in long COVID patients because of the arrhythmias that can occur and the autonomic dysfunction and the vascular dysfunction going on. These patients can have small fiber neuropathy. So small fibers are fibers that are sensory fibers and control your whole autonomic nervous system. So we see widespread pain and sensory sensitivities and orthostatic intolerance syndromes from small fiber neuropathy. These aren't really mutually exclusive. They're kind of, some of them are overlapping. We see mast cell activation. So mast cells release histamine, and in situations of chronic inflammation, the mast cells become unstable and sensitive and are triggering off histamine release too easily with very light provocation. And this can, mast cells are located in the mucosa of many, many areas of the body, in the airways, the GI tract, the vascular system, so that can really cause a multi-system disease. We've also had people develop central sleep apnea and obstructive sleep apnea and nocturnal hypoxemia. Cognitive impairment is remarkably important in long COVID. And even though cognitive impairment is a presenting symptom of having CFS, the cognitive impairment we've seen in our long COVID patients is worse than in our ME/CFS patients. And we do some cognitive testing before and after the nasaline test. And the baseline numbers are quite lower than our ME/CFS patients that we've been doing research on. And of course, we see a lot of dysmotility of the gastrointestinal tract. So think of these things when you're evaluating patients. I don't have time to go into how to work up all of these or treat all of these comorbidities. So there is one paper that was published by a colleague of mine, Lenny Jason, published in May of 2021. They surveyed 278 long haulers at week one and two after their COVID infection, and then the symptoms an average of 21 weeks later, and compared these symptoms to questionnaires of people with ME/CFS. And I think Lenny has a very large databank of patients with ME/CFS. And what he saw was there were more immune and orthostatic symptoms in long COVID. Remember that long COVID are right now, the long COVID we're looking at are people in the first year of their disease, or somewhere between 3 months to 12, now 15 months after their acute disease. We've seen many people who've been sick more than a year with long COVID. And when we look at ME/CFS patients, we're studying people who've been sick 5, 10, and sometimes even longer. So it may be that the presenting symptoms in long-standing disease are very different than symptoms early in a post-viral syndrome, or we're just going to see a different pattern in long COVID, and time will tell. So many symptoms improved in the long haulers over those 20, 21, 22 weeks, and especially the unrefreshing sleep and post-exertional malaise. Orthostatic symptoms were worse in long COVID, and neurocognitive symptoms in long COVID worsened over time, but this has remained slightly less common than in ME/CFS. And I think that in our clinic at BHC, we're seeing particularly severe cases of long COVID because those are the people who come to our clinic, and also people who think they might meet criteria for ME/CFS. So there's some selection bias to who we see in our clinic. So remember this slide. So these are common comorbid conditions in of interest in ME/CFS patients. And we sort of went through those. Well, this same list, we're definitely having emerging recognition of these common comorbid conditions in long COVID, which to me is just another argument that what we're seeing, the post-viral syndrome we're seeing after COVID, is going to end up, those who don't recover and end up with longstanding disease are probably going to look a lot like the way we define ME/CFS. The yellow ones are the ones that we've seen in our clinic in the literature in long COVID. And I think we've seen quite a few people with Sickle syndrome as well. Not necessarily Sjogren's disease, but Sickle syndrome. We just really haven't quantitated it yet. So early in the pandemic, I want to just point out, these articles are my colleague, Tony Komaroff, who is a Harvard professor and of internal medicine, who's done ME CFS research for 30 years. He published an article. I was a co-author with him in Frontiers in January. And then he and Ian Lipkin published a really good article on insights about ME-CFS and long COVID. And they're just emphasizing that it's very likely that ME-CFS, the post-viral syndromes from long COVID will look like ME-CFS. And we really need to be looking at the very things we're studying in ME-CFS. This is an article worth reading as well. This is called The Road to Addressing Long COVID. It was published as a viewpoint in Science Magazine at the end of July. And this is a really good article just pleading with us to be meeting the needs of long COVID patients now, that we should be diagnosing, reporting, we should recognize it, we should be able to include rehabilitation, and there should be a big effort in research. And the NIH has just earmarked and is distributing $1 billion in research money to study the long-term sequela of COVID. Also recently released for your reference, were CDC, the interim guidance from the CDC on long COVID for caring for patients. And the emphasis of these key points is that that post-COVID is an umbrella term. There are a wide range of physical and mental health consequences and for patients, and they're defining it as 4 or more weeks after the acute infection. And they're saying, you know, for what we know right now, these can be managed in primary care and to be very patient-centered to optimize their quality of life. And the last point on this page is emphasizing that, and this is good because we don't always hear this in the practice of medicine, the lack of laboratory or imaging findings does not invalidate the existence, the severity, or importance of a patient's symptoms and condition. So these patients, the early long hauler patients encountered, the 41% of them said they encountered disbelief or disdain or, you know, just minimizing their symptoms as being anxiety in the early part of the pandemic. And we really know now that that's not true. We're encouraged to set realistic goals and focus on managing symptoms and addressing comorbid conditions, just what we've been doing for ME-CFS for 20 years now. Help moderate severe symptoms like headaches or sleep disturbances or comorbid conditions like dysautonomias. And to treat them, you've got to assess them and really begin to you've got to pay attention and look for them. With a comprehensive management plan, working on physical, mental, social well-being after such trauma of this pandemic. And in understanding these post-COVID conditions, is just in its infancy, it's incomplete, and just have to prepare that we'll learn more and more and have better guidance as time goes by. So this is near the end. I want to emphasize some of the resources that what might be good for you there. Francis Collins, the director of the NIH, has been on top of this. He wrote an unprecedented blog in January recognizing the patient scientists of the long haulers who published their paper right after they published that paper, trying to emphasize the symptoms they were all suffering from. And this blog called upon scientists to rise to the occasion and start to study long COVID and understand it. This is what led to that large amount of money being appropriated to study post-acute sequelae of COVID. There was a workshop held to try to understand it. There is a really good CME, a COCA webinar, the one on the bottom, that was held in January from two female physicians, one a pulmonologist and one a neurologist, who were in the thick of the whole COVID epidemic in New York City, who continued to see patients in their clinic. It was really good. So there are some references here for mast cell activation, for the Dysautonomia International. And then we have for you, if you're interested, but also for patients that it can be helpful for, at our YouTube site, we have a number of educational videos, and we also have a very, very rich site on our website, batemanhorncenter.org, for many resources for both patients and providers who develop these syndromes and these comorbid conditions. So I think I'd like to turn the time over for questions, if that's okay.
We do have some questions, Dr. Bateman. The first one asks, if can a patient get post-viral syndrome symptoms, in particular extreme weakness and fatigue, from the COVID vaccine?
So, yeah, I mean, there's the first wave was people dying. The second wave was getting vaccinated. The third wave was long COVID. And now the fourth wave is what's happening to people who get the vaccine. We don't have enough data, but the answer is yes. Some people can certainly develop symptoms after the vaccine. What we don't know is how long it'll last and exactly what the nature is. And of course, we don't know how many people it's happening to. I think sometimes that's why it's important to distinguish what happens on social media and online anecdotally from what happens in a controlled study or a study that has the right denominator. I just read a study by the CDC that said of that 99.99% of vaccinated people did not get sick enough to go with COVID to go into the hospital or die. And so we'll just need to get the same kind of data as well and see what we can learn.
Thank you. Second question says, as a mother of three children under age three with a full-time job, the core criteria for ME/CFS sounds like symptoms of motherhood. To differentiate, does there need to be some other diagnosis, or does motherhood count for CFS?
Well, the fatigue we all feel is not ME/CFS, and that's what's hard to communicate. So the core criteria for ME/CFS require you to have disabling symptoms. That means you cannot carry out normal activities. You can't maintain your job. You can't attend school. It's impaired, impairment, number one. Number two is every time you try to do something, your symptoms flare and make you so sick again that you might be back in bed. So if you try to push through and do cognitive work, or push through and try to start to exercise, you relapse into very severe symptoms. And the cognitive impairment makes it difficult for people to work or do their schoolwork. And many kids, this is ME/CFS is the single most common diagnosis for the most common cause of extended school absence in children, for example, because they can't do their work. They're unable to do math. They're unable to critical reading, for example. And then orthostatic intolerance means you can't be up very long without feeling sick. So, I mean, that's a good question, but that's exactly why people need to understand what the criteria are. The post-exertional malaise is very unique. It's not the way we think of malaise. I don't really like that word. It's post-exertional relapse. So when people do too much, they develop low-grade fevers and tender lymph nodes, or, you know, their disease relapse the way they function is by staying within their energy envelope. They have to know about how much they can do and not do more in order to maintain stability and keep symptom burden low. So I hope that explains it. And that's what distinguishes ME/CFS from all other causes, even from those other comorbid conditions, but all the ordinary causes of fatigue. People with depression do not meet ME/CFS criteria, for example. People with anxiety, they might not feel like exercising, but exercise probably makes them feel better. Even fibromyalgia is an illness of widespread pain and fatigue. I'm a fibromyalgia expert, but the data are very strong that that low impact exercise, weight training, and exercise that's manageable within the pain amplification helps people with fibromyalgia. So even small amounts of exercise can relapse people with ME/CFS. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bateman.